Thanks so much, Brian. And thanks for the opportunity of this, Tim and Julian. The title of all this is Australian and Onshore Oil and Gas Boom. And I think you've probably heard enough from the guys today, John Hugh and Morris Brand at LNG, and also David Breeze talking about MEC Resources and the opportunities they've got. Now, I can say with quite a lot of pride that I was the underwriter for both LNG and Central Petroleum. It's really sad that we haven't made much money out of it, but I think the concepts involved here are really very exciting, and it's going to mean a lot of it will mean a lot to this country as we go through the next 20 years. The usual disclaimer we have to give. I'm going to start off with why we're going to have a boom. Now, if you saw the stuff that the previous presenters had put out, you would have seen quite clearly there's a lot of action to come through. But this is the thing that's going to drive the boom. Now, what this is the Australian ASX 300, and this is cash on deposit in the banks. Now, last month, we got the fabulous number of $1,340.9 billion in the Reserve Bank's numbers for bank deposits. Now, just to put that in perspective, this is the ASX 300. That's capitalised at about $1,150 billion at the moment, and the All Ords is $1,204 billion. So there's a lot more cash on the sidelines than there is in the market, and that just ain't going to stay there for too much longer, in my view. Otherwise, what we've had is the all the public has actually forecast the next recession and depression, and is all cashed up, repaid debt, and is all ready to batten down the hatches, and it's all going to end. But I don't think that's the way that's going to happen. I think we're going to see quite a strong move to the upside. The other thing, and this is for you, Julian, this is our Australia's export revenues. This is why we've got a real mining boom. Now, I noticed that there was a survey that came out and said 80% of Australia felt that they weren't participating in the mining boom. Well, I know that's true because here in Australia, I'm in the resource sector and I don't feel I'm participating in the resources boom either. It's pretty grim. And that's a complete disconnect, to use that terrible word, between reality and the marketplace. What's happened, we've seen our resource sector exports go from $50 billion in 2004 2009, they got up to $160 billion. In 2011, we actually got $175 billion. So there's been an extra $125 billion of export revenue that's come through, and it's come through from coal and iron ore, gold, and this thing here is actually LNG, and that's growing quite well. But a few years out, we're going to see $290 and possibly even $300 billion coming from our export revenues. Now, I've done these numbers without any increase in coal prices. These are all volume driven, and I've used $1.20 on the currency. So I think they're going to be conservative numbers. So we can see that we've got a resources boom underway that a lot of you don't feel what you're enjoying, but it is there. And we've got all that cash on the sidelines, it will come out. Now, Morris Brand with his LNG company is talking about LNG exports and all those projects that are taking place in Gladstone at the moment, and complementing the things on the North West Shelf and other parts of Australia. So this is the key to activity, and what it's doing is actually giving an exit for everyone to sell their gas at reasonable prices at last. Instead of people having stranded gas in areas away from the cities, away from infrastructure and pipelines, they're actually now going to get a reasonable export price, maybe $8 or $9 rather than $2 or $3. And we've also got a new generation of infrastructure in place. If you have a look at the pipeline infrastructure that we have in Australia at the moment, it's a hell of a lot better than it was in the last boom, which is sort of over 20 years ago. So this time around, new discoveries can go into gas pipelines fairly quickly. And one of the key drivers in all this is unconventional hydrocarbon. We've talked about coal seam gas, and we've also talked about shale gas. Now, the thing is that they can go out and discover these things and actually deliver it through this new generation infrastructure through our LNG export facilities. Lots of new technologies are being applied, and I'm sure what we're going to find with horizontal drilling taking place in Australia for the first time, that we're going to probably be able to teach the Yanks a few things within the next 10 years. Technology is really exciting. And the other thing is these frontier basins, things like the Amadeus Basin, the Beetaloo Basin, and we heard the Bonaparte Basin, that's in the dim, dark past, even the Sydney Basin. All these areas, the Officer Basin, Georgina Basin, there's a lot of gas in place, there's a lot of hydrocarbons in place. It's a matter of tapping it and having an economic market to develop it. So come to the key issues. Why is this all happening? The most important thing is that we've got really strong worldwide demand for energy. Now, this is a really, really important point. In the last few years, we've found that non-OECD consumption of energy has exceeded OECD. Now, I'll come back to that in a minute, but that is important because one's accelerating and the other one's stagnant. And given that non-OECD is accelerating and bigger now than OECD, overall energy consumption around the world is going to accelerate. So, peak oil, another thing. Has everyone here heard about peak oil? Anyone hasn't? Are we there yet? Well, look, who was that? Was that Lawrence?
Yeah.
You've got... Good. No, but no, you're not already there. It was in 2006 for conventional oil peaked, and we've only got natural gas liquids and a few unconventional oil picking up in the United States to allow us to maintain that sort of 89, 90 million barrels a day. But we've got real problems in the future. However you look at it, there's not enough oil around to maintain current production at today's price. The rise of unconventional hydrocarbon, total game changer in the United States. Huge increase in gas reserves and the gas price in the United States has fallen, and the US is likely to be an exporter of LNG rather than an importer. The other thing is that the United States domestic production is actually rising for the first time in about 20 years because of unconventional oil. I mentioned that global LNG market, it's about 220 million tonnes at the moment, and you could see by about 2020 it will be around about 380 million tonnes and a potential of being around 500 million tonnes by 2030, and Australia is going to be a major participant in that. We could be the world's largest player. We might not, but we could. But we've really got to manage what's happening at the moment. I mentioned non-OECD growth. It's bigger than OECD. We've been living with OECD economics, which have been sort of cyclical and really important, and the emerging countries and whatever, well, they were small and they didn't really matter. But now they're bigger. They might not be as big in terms of dollar economies, but in terms of consumption of basic raw materials, they're well ahead now, and this is accelerating. We're not going into any depression or in terms of consumption, it's going to increase. World energy patterns. This is really important to understand. This is a bit complicated maybe to go through with this at the moment, but two things to think about. China, 21%, sorry, this is world energy pattern, energy consumption by fuel type. And what it basically says, if we take China, 21% of their fuel is supplied by liquid fuels, 3% by gas, 70% by coal. Now, if anyone thinks that the Chinese coal industry and power industry is sort of slowing down in terms of coal consumption, they're sort of living in another world. It's just garbage, some of the stuff that's been talked about. Anyway, that basically means 3%, 3.5% here, they want this thing to go to 8 to 10%. If we look all around the world, we've got 24, 36% gas in other parts of the world. China has got to increase. So China is almost an unlimited sink for gas. So that has a big impact on what's happening in our boom. Peak oil concepts, discovery rates are too low. One of the things that's really important here is the risk of decline in the major supergiant fields. Now, these things make up over 40% of global oil, and when these things start to decline, Cantarell was doing over 2.5 million barrels a day. It's down to about 600 million barrels a day, and that fell over a period of about 4 years. Gawad is the world's largest field. It produces about 60% of Saudi output. There are real concerns about this. If this thing went into decline, we would find that there'd be real shortages of oil. Basically, Peak Oil says that there are all the reserves that we've been finding. This is our consumption. Clearly, we are consuming more than we're discovering, and that's the basic point. Unconventional hydrocarbons are really important in this boom that we're talking about. We have basin-centred continuous reservoir accumulations, get your mind around that, but they're tight gas reservoirs, includes coal seam methane, shale gas, shale oil, and they're a major new source of hydrocarbons. And but the really interesting thing about shale gas and unconventional is that it takes a lot of the exploration risk out. So instead of looking to see if we're going to be successful in finding gas, it's a matter of how we know that the gas is there, can we get it out? So we get a reduction in exploration capital risk, much higher capital up front, but these things tend to go for quite a long time. And this global expansion, it's really global, it's happening in China, it's happening in India, it's happening in South Africa, in Australia, in the United States. It's just beginning, and it's very, very positive for the future.
5 minutes
to go. So, we've got a lot of these things to talk about. Everyone knows it's big in the United States, and this is the way some of these things work. It's sort of like factories, gas factories underground, and that's the result of all the fracking. This is what some of these things look like, lots of horizontal wells that allow you to get together. Now, the international experience is really there, and it's going to apply to Australia in a big way in the years to come. This is some of the equipment. There's going to be massive, massive new industries, particularly in oil services. These things are pretty extraordinary. I've got this wonderful little thing which basically shows how underground fracking works, but we're not going to have time to go through all that. But it's a lot of fun. All these things here are individual frackings, and it basically shows how it's done. And Mr. Alan Jones should have a look at the way this thing works rather than going off. Now, in Australia, we've got lots of things. John Hugh had a far better graphic than mine, but basically, a lot of things happening in the Georgina Basin, and here we're talking about Petro Frontier. It's coming out of Canada. Big activity by the North American players. But in Australia, we've got stuff in the Cooper Basin. We've got Santos, Beach Petroleum, Drill Search. In the Amadeus Basin, where Central's drilling. The Beetaloo Basin, we put some money into a thing called Falcon Oil and Gas. They've got about 500 billion barrels of oil in place. We hope to get 4 or 5% recovery out of that, but still means around 15, 16 billion barrels of recoverable oil. Really important in getting this boom running. Georgina Basin, Officer Basin, Gippsland Basin, MacArthur Basin, Perth Basin, Canning Basin, Bonaparte Basin, and everywhere else, a lot of activity. And if you can't get one of these stocks, the Central Petroleum is capitalised at $60 million at 5 cents a share, and if some of their things come through, we're talking about $2.5 billion, which basically is 40 times your money. That's what we'd like to see, John, is that right? Yeah. So that's part of the boom. This LNG demand is growing, but these things are just everywhere in Australia. Georgina Basin. Well, these things are as big as the Bakken Shale, which is the biggest oil project in the United States. It's about 500 billion barrels of oil in place, and they're hoping to get about 3% recovery out of that. Georgina Basin is similar to that. All these numbers, new technologies, the Beetaloo Basin, places that you've never heard of, names you've never heard of, but they're going to be very, very significant in this boom to come. So I'm going to leave it there. I'm just going to say that all that cash on the sideline is going to say, holy cow, we shouldn't be sitting in the bank, we should be out there doing things. We're in the business of raising money for the smaller end of the market. It's been absolutely diabolical for 4 years, despite the fact that commodity prices are high and we see so many opportunities. It doesn't matter whether it's gold or oil or gas and whatever, but you can see that this is going to happen. And you people now are seeing the basic thing of being in stockbroking is that buy in gloom, sell in boom. You've got $1,341 billion behind you chasing stocks in the market. Thanks so much.
Barry, just before you go.